thank you so much for being here. It's an honor to have you as part of our Visionary Leadership Series. One of the big things that we're trying to accomplish with this series is really trying to guide some of us in the 35 to 40 year old age bracket as we're struggling between family and work-life balance, entrepreneurial career versus working in an employer type based career, yep. etc. How did some of those decisions get made in your life, and what kind of advice, as we are trying to think through those types of issues, would you kind of recommend for us to be thinking about?
Yeah, it seems to me that if you're working at an executive level, you know, you're going to be expected to work more than 40 hours a week if you're a VP or executive VP, whether you're in your own business or whether you're working for somebody else. My first, two jobs were at a business school working for somebody else, but I worked hard, and as long as it took. I had a young family at the time, so I was mindful of how much I was away. In fact, I remember when I was at Sea Pines, I would travel a lot, and then when I was back at Hilton Head, I would entertain during the week, so my wife said, we had two young girls, this is not fair, you're going to play golf on weekends. And took most of the day, and she was right. And so I quit golf for 20 years and took up tennis, which I could play at lunch, after work, and be home for dinner. But I think you should expect as an executive, whether you're running your own company or working for some other owner, to work fairly hard. I was commenting earlier today that I've always thought 55 hours a week was about the right time. And when I got out of Harvard Business School, I stood at the top of my class, and I could have been a Naval Academy grad also. I could have gone to any of those, Goldman, Morgan. I wouldn't even take an interview in New York because I knew they wanted your life. Mm-hmm. They wanted you for 70 hours a week. Mm-hmm. I was 29 at the time. I had one young daughter, and I said, I'm not doing that. I'm going to take a chance that I can make a good living moving to a part of the country where I want to go. So I gravitated, because I'm from Arlington, Virginia, to the southeast. And I found a business in Palm Beach, and it didn't work out, and then I went to Hilton Head, but I always stayed south. Mm-hmm. You know, the only thing that's got me up north is I remarried 15 years ago, and she sucked me up to New York, but we're also in Florida for the winter at this point. So I thought about that, and then I got an opportunity to join Trammell Crow. And I was making $100,000 a year, which was reasonably good money in 1978. And I had kids, I had no net worth, no savings. And I thought to myself, I remember my dad saying Bill Marriott offered him a job when he built the first Marriott, you know, near Key Bridge, mm-hmm. I think it was in Arlington. And he didn't take it, and he always resented it. But my father was a product of the Depression and was very security conscious. And so I always remember that. So when I got an offer to join the Crow organization, to go from $100,000 salary to $60,000, but to own 40% of my company, Crow family owned 40, Terry Golden, the senior partner, owned 20, I thought, you know, this is a tough time, got young girls, but if I don't do it now, I'm 43, when am I ever gonna do it? And so I just took a chance and moved on, and you know, I find, you know, then of course you kind of set the pace as the right. CEO. But my attitude is work 55 hours a week as a principal and spend the rest of the time with your family and take vacations. You know, mm-hmm. there's some people that don't take a vacation. I don't know if they think that's heroic or what, but you know, you need to clear your mind, you need to exercise, you need to take care of yourself and your family, and spend time with your family so you have a good family. So when you're at work, you can be at work, and I think that's the right life balance. It's a trade-off, but if you're ambitious, you're going to work more than a 40-hour week.
You took a very entrepreneurial route with Trammell Crow. A lot of us are entering new partnerships, considering partnerships, and Trammell Crow is one of the best as far as building a number of very high-quality partnerships. What are some of the key traits, processes, red flags, gut feels, how should we be looking at? What are some key facts we should be thinking about as we think about partnering with new people, entering these new partnerships, yeah. and trying to grow our business?
It's a great question. I had just had the good fortune to become a partner with the Trammell Crow family. It was initially Trammell Crow himself. Mm-hmm. Then when he no longer was active, it was his son Harlan. But Trammell, I thought, always wanted you to be successful. He kind of wanted an alignment of interest so that if you did a deal and it worked out, then you made money and the family made money. If you did a deal and it didn't work out, he didn't want the family to take all the losses. So the tricky time for the organization after I ended up taking it over and running it for almost 30 years was you couldn't wait for your partners to get wealthy, and they had their net worth, a lot of it, in the business, mm-hmm. so that you knew they were going to be very careful with what deals they recommended, what mm-hmm. projects they recommended, stewarding them, because we were all co-invest. We all had an alignment of interest. And that really worked well, and you know, I had the good fortune to own half the company, and the family owned half the company. And I had the same amount of money in it as they did, so they let me pretty much run it day mm-hmm. to day. And I appreciated that, but I also appreciated the generosity that Trammell expressed right at the outset. He wanted you to, you know, make money, not just because he made it along with you, but he wanted you to build a net worth. He wanted a group of successful partners. And I know in Trammell Crow Residential, I tried to emulate what I thought he wanted, and we mm-hmm. had well over 100 millionaires that were created when I ran the company, and some much more. Some of the biggest people in the industry today. Right. We started two REITs. Alliance Residential was right. one of them. Clyde Holland up in the Pacific Northwest yep. has done really well. So that was all, I think, from a partner-like partnership culture. I mentioned earlier today, I was talking about mentors. You know, in addition to Trammell and Charlie Frazier, my first boss at Sea Pines, that I learned as much from my partners,
right.
who were usually my senior partner group. They were 2, 3, 4, 5 years younger than me. They were well-educated, ambitious, great family man. We spent a lot of time recreating together, and I thought that was just, I mean, it was perfect. I love going to work. I mean, for 30 years, I love getting up and going to work. And mm-hmm. and that's the other thing I'd say to people is, put yourself in a position where you really like what you do. Because mm-hmm. when I was at the Henry C. Beck Company, I was a chief financial officer. I was kind of a fish out of water in a construction environment. I kept trying to find new things to do. I did their first ever strategic plan. Mm-hmm. I just didn't feel like I kind of fit, and I didn't look forward to going to work. Nice people, right. professional organization, but it was like night and day when I had the opportunity to be a Crow partner. As I say to people, Monday morning was just as exciting to me as Saturday or Sunday morning. Because mm-hmm. I couldn't wait to get back and get with a group and right. get going again.
Right. Another kind of big discussion that seems to be happening in our peer group right now is many of us have built local companies and we're starting to expand regionally or nationally.
Yeah.
And there's always a big question on, there's different philosophies. There's John McNellis will say, I only want to be in one city and I want to own 90%, 100%.
Right.
Trammell Crow took the very opposite or national platform, lots of partners. What are some of the pros and cons in your mind actually having to live in and grow at that platform? And how did you guys make the decision that you wanted to be at that scale versus regional versus local?
Yeah, it's a really good and interesting question. When I got to Trammell Crow Residential, they already pretty much had a precedent of being a national company. In residential, Lincoln Property Company was the original Crow company, and then and that kind of came apart in 74, mm-hmm. which gave actually me the opportunity. We had in the residential side the opportunity to do anything we wanted residentially. The commercial company, you know, was doing office buildings, occasionally a hotel, I guess industrial. Mm-hmm. And so we wanted to figure out what the best risk reward business was, and as I was reflecting on it, my first apartment business, I did in Atlanta, Georgia. I built it for $30,000, or we built it, my partners and I built it for $30,000. I didn't have many partners, that was my first deal, and sold it for $50,000, and I made over $1 million, and I was at that time in my 40s, and I had a net worth of $200,000, so that's when I fell in love with the apartment business. And I decided, Crow family was really open to whatever I wanted to do leadership-wise. I decided to stay in the apartment business and grow it nationally, because I thought, while there are differences, and that's why we have local partners, there are differences in zoning, climate conditions, and materials, it seemed to me much easier to underwrite an apartment in Denver than an office building. And I found that if you built the right product in the right location and you managed it well, that you pretty much could understand the business. You just had to take into consideration particularly local zoning. So my attitude was be in apartments and be across the country. Gave me volume. It wasn't so much that the economy in Denver was lousy and you could do a deal in San Diego. It was just that you were in a really solid business, which I think rental apartments are. And when the recession occurred, whether it was 91 or 2008, a large metro area like Atlanta, if you can finance your business so that you can get through the downturns. It's the other thing I always say to people is, you're never going to see the downturn coming. So finance your business. Don't over leverage it. Finance it so that you know you can carry through the downturn.
Right.
Kind of, how much equity do you have in it? How much debt? And when does the loan mature? If you go outside your metropolitan area, I encourage people to have really competent partners to know what doing business in Denver is like, or Seattle, or Portland. Some people do fly-ins and do it reasonably well. I think it's risky if you're not local.
Right. What are some of the tough decisions or tough calls you had to make when you were younger that you believe helped lead to the success that you've been able to have over the years?
Well, you know, important decisions, of course, are what product line to be in and what kind of risk profile to develop for your company. I'll never forget, it was, I think, 1992, and we were at this real estate summit in Aspen, and Sam Zell was orchestrating it, and I was giving the residential outlook, not on the apartment, but the condos. And at the end of my presentation, I said to the audience, the toughest thing for me to figure out is how much overhead to keep, because I don't know when development will be viable again. And Sam said, oh, Ron said, how much overhead to keep? Fire them all, Ron. You can hire them back when you want to. You know, like, easy for you to say, Sam. He actually called me and apologized for grandstanding, but... that's not right. You can't, the real best people you had. So the hardest thing for me, and the thing I hated the most, and maybe what motivated me to retire at the end of 08 and not go through another 2 or 3 years where you were having to let people, I hated letting people go who were really quality people. And yet, if you're a merchant builder, you know, your fees are running down and you can't afford the overhead because you have no capital to support them. So those were some of the hardest decisions I had to make. I kept, fortunately, I was able to keep my key partners, usually key construction guy, key development partners. Management, you could keep when we had management, you could keep them because you even hide some people in management.
right.
But, you know, development talent, you can't, because they're going to be with somebody else.
Right.
So that's kind of most painful decision process I ever had to go through.
Well, thank you so very much for the time.
Yeah, you're welcome.
I appreciate it and look forward to speaking to you in the future.